I want you to tell all your friends about me.
What are you?
I'm Batman.
It's not college basketball. It's clobbering time.
Let's get ready to rumble. Feel the fire, sense of the rare. It's my son, only know how.
What is up, Friday Nighters? Welcome back to another edition, another episode of Just Another Friday Night. I'm one of your two hosts, CM Chuck.
And I'm Double A.
That's Adamantium Adam, guys. As you can see, we are not in the same room as we normally are together, Double A and I. That is in part, well, not in part, that is all due to me. I had a bit of a medical procedure that is kind of keeping me out of moving around too much. So I'm working on recovering and being back in the pod lab there with Double A, because it's always better when we're in the same room than when we're apart. But Double A, how the hell are you, bud?
Good. Doing real good.
Good. Awesome, man. We got a fun one for you guys tonight. We don't want to take up too much time leading in, but we'll talk about a couple of things. But real quick, let's get into the comments real quick. We got Ramsey joining us. Is that right? Ramsey GT there from YouTube says hi. I like that monkey thing there. Pretty cool. Of course, our good buddies Toy Mafia in the house saying, what's up? What's up, Toy Mafia? And our very good friend Aurelis Delgado in the house saying hello. What is up, Aurelis? We appreciate you being here. Richard in the house says, what's up, my brothers? What's up, Rich? Rich's Colts got a win this past week, right, Double A?
Yeah, I think they're doing pretty damn good this year.
There you go, so Rich. It was your time, brother. Double A's team got a win last night too, right, Double A?
That game was boring.
Oof, man. But you know what? I feel for your brother, because these Giants really suck, man.
It was funny. I saw, like, someone said they had a picture of, what's his name, Daniel Jones?
Yeah.
And Dak hugging, and they're like, 400 and something million spent on these two guys, and it was a battle of kickers last night. I was like,
yeah, man, it just plays into the fact that Thursday Night Football can't get it going, right? It's like, man, I felt like our group chat, right? Like, I was watching it because I was like, okay, football's on. I'm just recovering. Yeah, we put it on. I've got Prime, right? And I was like, man, this shit's putting me to sleep, man.
I think I told you guys, I was like, man, it's getting boring.
Yeah.
You know, I was like, man.
Yeah, at work, tough. I'm in a.
It was tough. It was tough to watch last night.
Yeah.
That was just all kicks.
Yeah. I mean, I think we can understand, you know, so you want your team to get a win, but sometimes the game is just boring, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, thank you, Rich. I appreciate that, brother. Hopefully so. Again, mentally good body is just not where it needs to be yet. Man, the commentators didn't help. Yeah.
I didn't even hear that part, so I think I was listening to like music in the background, so I didn't really even hear what they were saying.
I told Double A, Rich, I ended up saying, hey, I think I'm gonna look at Braveheart. I haven't seen Braveheart in a while. Watch that movie. But yeah, I'm actually in a fantasy league at work, and I was the team I'm playing this week against, she has Dak as her quarterback. So I was like, man, I better watch to see if this guy has like a big game. And I was like, man, he didn't have a big game, but you know, he still did enough to put up points for the fantasy team.
Okay. I was gonna ask you, what kind of points do you put up when he has like a game like that?
Yeah. I'd have to actually check to see exactly what he had up, but her team is pretty solid, and she's undefeated in our league this year. So, So I'm like, man, and well, you know, the game that y'all had last week where he lost, he still put up like a bunch of points because he threw for a bunch of yards.
Yeah, so, that's okay.
So last night he only put up 16.74 points. So that.
So what's a really good game? What is a really good game? Put how many points do you put up?
Let me see here. Like, let me look at if I can see. Well, like, for instance, when I had, like, Alvin Kamara that week they beat y'all, man, I think he put up, like, 40 points. So that's great. Okay. You know what I mean? So, I mean, you know, you want to try to hit, like, in those ranges above. But they average about, like, 20, you know, 22 is a good amount for, like, a quarterback, a good running back, good wide receiver. Depending on what kind of league you're in.
I don't play any of that. So I wouldn't even know what the hell is good or – what's bad? 20 sounds like a lot. Oh, yeah, okay.
Like Richard says there right there, pretty good. Yeah. Okay. But yeah, that's a little bit of sports. Anything else, AA, going on in the world of pop culture that struck you that was interesting this week?
Especially for quarterback. Okay.
Yeah, 24
okay.
quarterback is okay. good. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, I felt like there was, but I'm drawing a blank.
So I feel like we got that Thunderbolts trailer. That was pretty sweet, right?
Thunderbolts. Yes.
Did you check it out, or you didn't check out the trailer?
Yes, I did. And The Last of Us dropped, right?
Yes. That one I didn't watch the entire trailer. I just saw the beginning, and I meant to come back to it, and I didn't come back to the rest of it. But
that dropped, which everybody's like really anticipating that. Thunderbolts. Yeah. How do you feel people are doing on that one? You think that's getting attention, or I mean?
Well, the big thing for me in that trailer was that it seemed like we're going to get the Sentry, right? Which I don't want.
I'm not excited about it.
I don't want Marvel to do the Sentry. I've never felt like the Sentry was a great character. Again, your classic Superman ripoff. I just was like,
big time.
And I'm like, I feel like Marvel has so many other great, powerful characters,
right?
That aren't like a Superman. Yeah, you've got Silver Surfer, you've got Thor, you've got, Hulk, you've got so many, much more interesting, creative characters than, and what was the original story with the Sentry AA? That he was created by, like, they made him seem like he was an old character, but he was actually new, And so that was
the dude is like schizophrenic, I believe. And I think when he goes like really off course, like he's supposed to be almost damn near unbeatable.
Right.
Which is why they sent him in to deal with Planet Hulk, World War Hulk.
Yeah. But he then still Hulk got beat him. Up, right? Yeah.
Yeah, the Hulk beat him, and then I thought that was kind of put to rest.
Yeah.
And like that was it. Like, okay, cool. They wrote this character off. You know what I mean?
Right.
Yeah, but I guess he's gonna have a comeback, so watch for all his issues coming up.
I felt like he was a kind of a big part in that new Avengers too, when they had done the Avengers that had Wolverine and Spidey in it. Which again, that's fine. I mean, there's been a lot of iterations of the Avengers, but I felt like when they did that new Avengers, they were trying to Justice League it too, right? Let's get all of our bigs on one squad, I did see you post this trailer, AA, but I didn't get to watch it. But Richard asked, did you see the trailer for Ballerina, the John Wick spinoff?
Well, I like the actress.
Ana de Armas, right?
I don't know, man, if these are going to fly. I mean, I really didn't even hear anything too much about that hotel one. Like, it felt like it just kind of came and went, and...
Yeah.
I don't know. I mean, she's a good actress. She really is. Maybe she'll pull it off.
I think she's great. Yeah, I haven't seen the trailer yet, Rich, and I do want to check it out. I saw AA put it in our group, so I want to go in and check it out. But I like her a lot. I think, didn't she do a movie with Chris Evans that was on Apple? Gray Man, something like that?
Was it that one?
No, maybe it wasn't.
I'm not too sure. No, you know what? I think they did team up. They teamed up in Knives Out, and then they teamed up for another movie, too. Okay. Yeah, you're right. I don't know which one it was, but I think they did team up again.
I need to go check out some more of her stuff, but I like her and what I've seen her in.
Well, I know she came out like in Blade Runner, right? Mm-hmm. The second one. She's come out in Knock with Keanu Reeves. She was getting that one. What else? She came out in some Ben Affleck movie that was like super hot at the time.
Huh.
And
I think she was in that. I liked her. I think I saw her a little bit in that Yesterday movie, the one with the Beatles guy. He's like,
oh, she's in that one.
I think she is. I think she plays like a celebrity in that one. There's a like, she has like, some little scenes in there, and it's pretty cool. Rich says, the trailer is amazing. He says the show, The Continental, is good, but it starts off slow. Yeah.
Which again, why do these shows always keep, starting off slow? You know what I mean? Like,
I know, we've been saying that.
Get on with it.
Right. I wouldn't mind giving it a shot to check it out. You know what I mean? The Continental. I think it's on Peacock, right?
Peacock, that's right. That's right.
And real quick, AA, this one, we were talking about this, but Richard asked us,
We felt like I'm on almost, like, 15 minutes into episode 5. I've seen episodes 1 through 4, and I'm into like about 15 minutes of episode 5. So I like it a lot. It shows a lot of good footage, a lot of behind the scenes footage, a lot of talking heads, like real important wrestlers that talk about what he did and everything. So I've been enjoying it. I've been liking seeing the old footage.
I definitely want to check it out. And I know that a fellow wrestling fan that's joining us tonight, and kind of the reason why we're all gathered through here for tonight's episode, right, Double A? Double A, when was the last time we chatted with this gentleman? It's been a little bit, right?
It's been a little bit, yeah.
But we had him on in before the last episode. I'm sure he'll remember. But for those of you guys that don't know, next week is a local comic show, and it is being headed up by a guy I would consider a friend of ours now, a friend of the podcast, but our good friend, Mr. Nas Rodriguez, and we'll bring Nas into the house now to talk with us. Nas, how you doing, buddy?
What's going on, y'all?
Hey, what's up?
Doing good, man. Good to see you.
I see y'all are talking some Mr. McMahon, huh?
Yeah, man. Yep. Did you already get into it?
No, I haven't watched it yet, but I just listened to a Bill Simmons podcast the other day where they were talking about it, because it was I didn't know that he was involved with it. Simmons was.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. And they were talking about just like how weird it was, like behind the scenes with Vince, right? That like he'd come in late and he'd kind of just be on his own schedule, and there were certain things that like he didn't want to answer or talk about. It was interesting to hear some of the behind the scenes from the people that were making it, you know?
Okay, that's interesting.
That classic gif now, right, where he's like that.
Yeah,
he's all crying or whatever. I'm like, he just strikes me as the kind of guy that could cry on cue. You know what I mean?
Oh, like, yeah.
I just feel like Vince has that talent.
Yeah, I'm sure.
But Nas, how the hell are you, bud? When did we last talk, Nas? We talked to you before, in between CASA shows.
It was a couple months ago. It wasn't that long.
Yeah. What was our? Did we have a specific subject, or were we just chit-chat?
I think we talked about a bunch of stuff, right?
Yeah. Kind of like the state of the comic book business at the time.
Yes. Yeah. That's what it was. Yeah. Kind of what's going on in current events and current affairs.
Yeah, man.
That was a great way.
As far as how I'm doing, I'm just it's right at the end here, right? Like you said, we're a week away. I'm kind of stressing out a bit, but at the same time trying to relax and like figure like, okay, I've done everything I can, but yeah, it's a balance right now.
Well, Nas, if we know you and we like to think we do, and we've been to your, you know, the last year's show, it's going to be great. You know what I mean? It's going to be a fun show.
Yeah. Y'all are going to be at this one, but at a table this time.
I know, weird, right? I'm like, man, we're gonna have to work out our schedule for me and Double A to walk around there. But let's talk a little bit about, and I'm rocking the gear here, and
I got
the merch on, baby.
I see it.
Let's talk a little bit, Nas, about CASA for those people that are joining us that don't know, because you know, we're streaming with our friends now, Collecting Weekly, and we've seen a little bit of an uptick in some of our viewership, which is always great. So for those that don't know, talk to us a little bit about CASA, aka Comic Art San Antonio.
Yeah, definitely. So as you mentioned, it's a comic show here in San Antonio. 2024, this year's show will be our third annual show. But, you know, it's kind of like it's the first show again. We're going to be at a new venue. We're going to be at the Marriott San Antonio Airport in their La Cantera Ballroom. It's the first year that we're flying in guests for the show. It's just kind of like, even though this is the third one, it seems all new because we're just doing things that we haven't done for the previous ones. But our main thing is we focus on comics and comic creators. So, you know, we've got some really great pop culture shows here in San Antonio and in the surrounding area. But CASA tries to focus on just the comic books, just the comic creators. So everyone there is going to be a comic book writer, a comic book artist. You know, we're going to have like the bigger names that worked on Marvel and DC and that kind of stuff, like Christopher Priest and Rob Guillory. But the majority of our exhibitors are going to be people that are creating their own stories, you know, new independent stuff that hopefully when attendees are out there, they'll find like some new stuff that they've never heard of and they're discovering, you know?
I love that, man. I love that. And I know I was kind of re-listening to our first conversation with you earlier today, and we talked about kind of going old school, right? To the times before maybe even ourselves here when you know.
Well, I mean, maybe yourselves. I'm a little older than you guys. So.
Not by that much. But, you know, the time, right, AA, when you know, comic shows were in a
Yeah, in a hotel lobby.
In a hotel lobby, right? Yeah. And it was a couple of, you know, writers and artists, you know. We were really blessed, Nas, to this past year, you know, we had AA had got me to watch that Bill Finger doc, right?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And it was amazing, right? Mm-hmm. You know, and I was actually watching it, and like over my shoulder, my girlfriend was watching it, and she was like, she couldn't believe that. She's like, what an insane story about, you know, Batman. And then of course, you know, we got to talk to Athena Finger, you know, we had her on the podcast and talk with her about that. But just that clip from the movie where it says like, oh, we were, you know, in this bar, and then like, here's these guys, and they're like, you want to meet the co-creator of Batman? And I was like, yeah. When I think about, you know, the type of show that you're doing, Nas, it's like that. It's like going back, you know, in time, you know.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, that's some of the earliest shows that I remember that were actually like not too far from where we're doing the our show, not too far on 410, if you know the Crown Plaza there.
Yeah,
that's one of the earliest ones that I remember. It was just in one of the hotel ballrooms. It was a whole bunch of vendors with long boxes all around the perimeter of the room. And I don't even think they had any comic guests at that one. But like, there's some other ones that like they would have like one or two guests like in the corner somewhere. And I was never lucky enough that it was like a Stan Lee or a Jack Kirby or something, but I've heard those stories about like, yeah, I went to a hotel show and Jack Kirby was sitting in the corners.
Wow.
Yeah. Wow. So yeah, definitely that is something that kind of we're throwing it back to shows that comics were the focus, right? You know, it's awesome to meet your favorite celebrities from the MCU or from whatever, but we wanted something that focuses exclusively on the comic book creators.
Yeah, and I love that, man. It's a very, I think that's an awesome niche to put yourself into with this show. And I think that's one of the reasons why AA and I love it so much, because, you know, it is so comic centric. But yeah, no, exactly. So talk to me, Nas, a little bit about the, you know, I remember last time around we were talking CASA, you said, you know, you have a shop, obviously, you know, your day-to-day job that's there in the Wonderland, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. But you've moved from the Wonderland and you're moving into, again, the hotel ballroom type mm-hmm. thing. Why the move? Why make that move and go from kind of your home base in a sense?
Well, I mean, the Wonderland was great to us for those first two shows for us to get started. But one thing I was never happy with is that it's hard to tell exactly what your attendance is, because you don't know if people are there just walking around the mall or if they came for the show. And then another thing, if we wanted to keep growing and fly in guests, you know, unfortunately, we do have to charge at least a small admission fee to try to cover that. And we try to keep it cheap. You know, it's going to be $8 to get in. But even that $8 that everyone pays to come in, you know, that helps us bring in like Christopher Priest, like Terry Cavanaugh, that kind of stuff, you know?
No, that's great, because I think that fans that love comic books like we all do are not going to mind that, because number one, $8 is a great admission price for anything nowadays, yeah, right? Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. You know, and especially to get an opportunity to, you know, spend time with some of those creators that, you know, people have really wanted to meet. I know, you know, some of the shows we go to now, nothing's under $10, you know what
yeah
I mean?
Man, you can't even get a hot dog for that one. But you know, another thing is too, like, I know us, and I'm including myself in that when I say us comic geeks, right? We're $8, if it was $10, if it was $20, we'd probably still show up there, right?
Oh yeah.
But I'm really trying to keep it cheap for maybe the person who's not a comic like nerd yet. Maybe they're curious about it and they want to check out this show. Or the family that, you know, mom, dad, and like a couple of kids want to come and they want to introduce their kids to comics. So I wanted to keep it, you know, affordable for everybody to come check it out. Even if you don't love this stuff yet, if you're just checking it out and you're curious about comics, you know?
No, totally, man. And I think that's mm-hmm. a perfect price point, and you're definitely going to, I think.
Yeah, it really is. I mean, sometimes the admission fees, I told TM this the other day, sometimes the admission fees are kind of what throws me off. Yeah. I'm like, shit, you know, I'm not even going to spend that much on the person I'm going to go see. I'm going to pay more just to get in. Yeah. And to actually meet the person.
Yeah. Or by the time you pay just to get in, like, you don't even have much left in your pocket to go shopping or go get the things you want, you know? Yeah.
Yeah. You got to try to cut those corners where and when you can.
Yeah. And that's one thing, you know, I didn't want to do. Like, I want people when they come into the show that I haven't already taken all the money out of their pocket, right? Like, they can walk around the show and they still got that money to pick up that comic from that indie creator that they found or something like that, you know?
Absolutely, man. Because, you know, you're helping them out and then, you know, they're giving back also too by giving their time and being there.
Yeah.
So tell us a little bit, besides obviously the different venue, what else is different about CASA this year? Are there other things you've done differently or are doing differently that we can look forward to?
Well, there's been a lot more outreach this year. So we've got our postcards and flyers and posters in any comic or game shop within a 2-hour drive of San Antonio. So
awesome.
I think once I started seeing that, like, some comic creators were going to be joining us from Dallas, from the Valley, from Houston, from everywhere, I was like, you know what, let's go ahead and get our postcards into those shops. And, you know, even though it might be a long drive and some people aren't going to make it out, like, at least they'll find out about the show. They'll hear about the show. And you never know. Maybe if they don't come out this year, maybe they check us out for next year or something. So that's definitely one, you know, more outreach. Last year you guys were one of the like three podcasts, I think, that were nice enough to interview me. This year I've been trying to reach out to more. I did an interview with the San Antonio Bibliotheque, their online library.
Awesome.
I can't say anything yet, but we might be working with Council District 1 on something since the hotel is in District 1. So, yeah, just definitely more outreach, trying to get the word out there more, you know?
Yeah, I love it, man. And you're doing all that stuff kind of old school, right? And I was like, you're the one driving around taking flyers to shops and meeting shop owners, right?
Yeah, that's why I said I'm pretty stressed out and worn out right now. So.
That's what Double A and I were talking about. He was like, man, you know, we never know, like, how busy you are and how much time we're, like, we're getting right down to the nitty gritty. So
we definitely
did want to give, you know, the opportunity for you to talk about this and you know, again, we're excited, you know, to be kind of getting to be a little small part of this, you know, with, of course, with Alfred, our good friend from Comic Book Creators. If you guys know, you know, Alfred and the things he does with Collector's Cove, it's always fun. He's always out at Ekman's show and anywhere I could see, you know, selling stuff. And he makes it a really great time, too. So to be kind of seeing him on the podcast side of things will be fun. Nas, are you having, I would assume, yes, you are having like regular vendors as well that are selling stuff.
So we do have three of the local comic shops. So we've got Big Alpaca Comics coming. Gotham Newsstand will be there. And Nelco Comics will be there.
Nice.
And then I wanted to have one toy vendor because, you know, I know that there are people that are involved in, that are interested in that kind of stuff. So Ekman's Books and Collectibles, you know, they opened a store about a year or two ago. Mm-hmm. So they'll be there. They actually might be bringing mostly comics, but I did tell Dale if he wanted to bring some like Marvel Legends and kind of stuff like that, he could. And then you guys might have heard of them. It's a company that does custom short boxes, boxes in action.
Yeah.
They'll be there. So yeah, those are our four vendors and five vendors. And yeah, everyone else is a comic creator.
That's nice. Great, nice. Guys. Dude, you've got it really fine-tuned to like the best of the best, right? Like, you know, you've got Dale there, you've got, you know, Nelco, you've got, you know, got the Big Alpaca. That's like some of the bigs here in town that are, you know, that are not the other two, you know what I mean? You know, Alien Worlds and Heroes, not that we don't love them, we do, you know what I mean? But that's really awesome because I heard about some of these guys from you know what I mean? So
yeah, and they're all different flavor, you know, like Dale, like I said, he's got toys if he wants to bring them. Nelco specializes in like 90s and older stuff. Big Alpaca and Gotham, they both, you know, provide you with like trade paperbacks and current comics. But Big Alpaca does a little more with like CGC and key issues, while Gotham is really focused on like the reading and the art and all that kind of stuff. So the few vendors we do have, each one is kind of specialized and has their own flavor, you know?
I love that. I got to go to NELCO with Double A. We met with Bill. I think it's Bill.
Bill,
right?
Bill Field. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, Bill Field. We were hanging with Bill, and we were just like, I think Double A, you know, was equally blown away by just like the volume and the great books they have there under the glass and in the back issues, and just like, you know, we were like, we might not have brought a heavy enough pocketbook for today, but some great stuff. He had showed
definitely.
Us. Like
if you're looking for some old like Silver Age stuff or something like that, check out NELCO and check out that back wall they've got.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I think that day he got in, I think it might have been a first appearance of Lizard, and he was showing it to us. And I was like, man, that's gorgeous, man.
Yeah. That's right.
So it's very cool. He was just about to close up, so he stayed open for us. Bill let us have some time there and look around, hang out. And me and Double A got some cool stuff before we walked out.
Yeah, man.
And then I hadn't got a chance to go with Double A, but I made my way over to Gotham because I know you'd mentioned them several times. Mm-hmm. So I visited the store on Broadway, and I was like, okay, great. This is a great spot for like new books. You know what I mean? Like you can get all your new books, your trades there. They had all that stuff. Just
And if you haven't been by recently, definitely go check out the Broadway location again. They've done a remodel. They've added more shelving and stuff. So like just they've got. The whole like side and back of the walls are all just trade paperbacks and graphic novels. So
nice. Right. Nice. Yeah, we got to go check that one out, Double A. I think you really like that shop too.
Yeah, for sure.
You haven't been at all, Double A?
No, I haven't. I haven't made my way over there.
Man, get over there, man.
Yeah,
I will.
Yeah. I'm telling you. I told Double A they got the dollar books, man, under the table. You can hit those. That's we've been living in those boxes lately, Nas, me and Double A.
Oh, and let me throw a shout out to one of our vendors. If you go over to Ekman's, all their $2 comics are $1 right now.
Ooh, so, there you go.
Yeah. I spent like 3 hours there the other day and I only made it halfway through the boxes. So.
I love it, man. I love it.
But yeah, other than the outreach and the venue, like I mentioned earlier, the other new thing is we're flying in guests. You know, this is the first time we're bringing in guests from outside the area. We've still got like so many great creators we're lucky that here in San Antonio in the Austin area, we've got a lot of great creators like Sean McKeever and Chris Sheehan, Chris Allen, that kind of stuff. But this is the first time that we're flying in some guests.
Dude, that's great, man. Mm-hmm. And now we're still doing, it's just one day, correct?
Yeah. The original plan was to try to expand to 2 days. Mm-hmm. But I think I had, when I talked to you guys last time, it was just so difficult finding a venue and dates and kind of stuff like that.
Right.
That I decided to just go ahead and stick to one day again this year. And depending on how this goes and how everything goes with the Marriott, we'll see about next year being 1 or 2 days.
That'd be awesome, man. Yeah, no, that'd be really awesome. But no, I think too, one day is sometimes great. Like, you know, we talked about Ekman, right? He's always done one day. And I think it's always been really, you know, good to him. So we're going to definitely.
I like the one day because, you know, it's in and out. You know, people get back to their lives and their homes and stuff.
Absolutely.
The only thing that I have noticed that makes it a little difficult is getting guests because a lot of times, you know, a creator, and rightfully so, you know, like they don't want to be away from their family, they don't want to be away from their work. Because if it's a 2-day show, you know, they have to fly in the Friday before and then leave the Sunday after. So that's already like 4 days commitment from them. So I understand that. So that's one of the reasons why we're looking at 2 days. But like I think I had talked to you guys last time about it, about like, you know, trying to grow slow, like don't get too big for my britches yet. So we'll see, man. We'll take it year by year and see how it goes.
No, it's great, man. And again, you know, crawl before we walk, and I think you're definitely doing things right, Nas, with that, especially, you know, bringing in these outside guests, you know, people that obviously you're really excited for. And I think everyone's going to be excited to see and to meet and talk with. So
it's yeah, I'm awesome, definitely dude. Excited. Like, I think it's a good mix. You know, I wanted kind of some of the older legendary creators, like, you know, Terry Cavanaugh worked on the Clone Saga, worked on a lot of 90s Moon Knight. That kind of stuff. You know, he did stuff a few years ago with Grimm, with Zenoscope for Grimm Fairy Tales. Same thing, Christopher Priest, like everyone remembers his Black Panther run from the late 90s. But just this year, he got nominated for an Eisner with Superman Lost, that miniseries. And then not only those guys who, you know, have been doing stuff since years and decades before and still doing stuff, but then someone like Rob Guillory, who's known for all his creator-owned stuff with Chew and Farmhand and Mosley and that kind of stuff. So, trying to do like a mix of creators there.
No, man, that's awesome. I love it too. And I really see this as being the type of show to, you know, draw in the people that are really, you know, into comic books and comic mm-hmm. heavy stuff. And it's like, man, finally a show that's not kind of driven by the TV and movie celebrity aspects. You know what I mean? Yeah. It's really going back.
Yeah.
But besides the show, Nas, and again, we could talk all about CASA as much as you want, but we know you're stressed and we want to relieve some of that a little bit, hopefully. Yeah. Nas, what have you been getting into that you've had time for outside of you know, working on this show? Are you reading anything? Are you watching anything? Or are you looking forward to anything?
My wife and I just finished Cape Crusader. That was really good.
Yeah.
I liked that a lot. Like, it was reminiscent of Batman the Animated Series, but it wasn't so similar that you felt like you were just watching more of the old stuff. So I really dug that. Diedrich Bader as Harvey Dent, Two-Face. I was really liking that, man, because, you know, I have him in my head as the Batman Brave and the Bold Batman. So for him to be the bad guy now, I was like, oh, this is a pretty good performance, you know? So we really dug that. What else? As far as reading, you know, I'm still continuing on my Amazing Spider-Man read through. So I put up a post a few days ago. I'm up to like August 1996 now. I still have a long way. I've made it through like a lot of the Clone Saga stuff. And I posted about that too, that, you know, the Clone Saga gets such a bad rap, but there's some good stuff in there, you know?
Dude, everything old, with when you put new eyes on it, you're like, hey man, this is not that bad. You know, I was telling AA, we talked about it a few weeks back, when they had Sony had re-released all the Spider-Man movies in the theater, right? Mm-hmm. So my nephew wanted to go. He's like, let's go. The one he enjoyed the most was Spider-Man 3, because he said, well, the crowd was really into it. And they were, like, everyone, it just, because we knew that it was going to be hokey and funny.
Yeah.
We were like all laughing together. I was like, you know what? This isn't so bad when viewed through this lens, you know?
Yeah, that's how the Clone Saga was, man. Like, of course, there was some stuff that wasn't as great. Because, like, if you've heard any of the interviews with the creators from that time or anything, they were basically forced to keep this story going that they, like, they had a plan for. They had a beginning, a middle, and end, and then marketing at Marvel is just like, hey, this is selling well. Just keep it going. Keep it going. So, yeah, of course, under those circumstances, there's some stuff that's not as great. But I'm really enjoying Ben. Like, you know, I've already gotten to the part where, you know, he's transitioned from the Scarlet Spider to he's the Spider-Man, you know.
Wow. Okay.
Nice.
Peter and Mary Jane just came back from Portland. And so, yeah, man, it's some really good stuff. I'm digging it. And then as far as current stuff, like I just stopped at the comic shops today. I picked up Dick Tracy, number 5. That series from Mad Cave has been really good. So if anyone's interested in that, I would definitely recommend it. What else am I, man? There's a bunch of stuff that's on my to be read pile, and I just haven't gotten to it.
That's AA and I both, I'm sure, as well. He gets sometimes around more than I do, but I'm like, man, I've got like a stack that's sitting over there. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I figure once CASA's done with, I'm just gonna like veg out for like a week and just read a bunch of stuff.
Good, man. Good. You'll definitely have earned it, for sure, Nas. Nas, what about, like, are you doing any of the big Marvel stuff? Did you guys do Agatha?
Oh, yeah. I forgot about that. We just watched episode 3 last night.
Okay, good.
I'm really enjoying that, too. You know, I don't want to spoil anything since it just came out, but, you know, the mystery going on with who Teen is, like,
yeah,
you know, we've all got theories and stuff, so I can't wait to see what happens with that, but yeah, man, I'm enjoying that too. And it's another one of those where, like, before it was released, it was people were trying to get it review bombed. And I'm like, what are y'all talking about? This is good.
Yeah. I think AA's a little bit behind on catching up with that one. I just caught up today. Yeah. And I felt the same way too with this third episode. I was like, oh, it was pretty strong. Yeah.
How far along are you, AA?
Just like on episode 1 right now.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, because I'm watching some other things. The Penguin, and I was watching some other shit. I can't remember.
Yeah, we need to get to Penguin. That'll probably be like one of our next ones.
I wonder what your thoughts are on that, Nas. Yeah, for sure.
Did you already watch it?
Yeah, episode 1 was really good.
Okay. And you, Chuck, did you already watch
it? Yeah, I saw episode one also. I saw it after AA. I did Agatha first, so then I was waiting to catch up with that. But then I saw it, and I texted him right away, and I was like, okay, I like where they're going with this. Okay. This is going to be cool. And he was one of the bright spots to me of the Batman movie. Yeah, so I really am enjoying it. And again, too, I was kind of watching, and my girlfriend wasn't really watching with me, but then she started to watch. She was like, started asking questions, so I knew she was kind of getting interested, which I like.
Are they doing weekly releases on that one, too?
Yeah, I think it's going to be Sundays.
Sunday. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, so we've got Agatha on Wednesdays. Sundays, we've got Penguin to look forward to. So, yeah.
Okay.
And Ms. Arellas, I won't put your comment up because I don't want to spoil it for anybody. But, yeah, that was very cool when we saw that. When I actually mentioned that to AA, I was like, has that been mentioned before? Have they said that name? And he said, I don't think so. I said, yeah, it was very casual how they slipped that in there.
I know what you're talking about. And I told my wife, too. I was like, so that makes it official. Like, he exists in the MCU.
Right, yeah. I went back. I was like, let me go back and make sure I heard what I heard.
Yeah, yeah.
I was like, hold on. So
well, cool. Always watch with captions on just to make sure we don't miss anything.
Yeah, right, okay. Yeah. I actually, I watch once without, and then I go back, and then I look at it again with them on, so I can be like, what did they say?
But as far as I was reading, I was pulling up my pull list right here. I'm reading the Masters of the Universe Revolution from Dark Horse. The Spider-Man Reign 2 miniseries. I've got that. Okay. And then the Death in the Family, Robin Lives one. I know, AA, you're a big J.M. DeMatteis fan. He's writing that miniseries. It's if Jason wouldn't have been killed by the Joker.
Oh, okay. Nice.
Yeah. DeMatteis writing and Rick Leonardi on art. So
Leonardi. Yeah. Nice.
Yeah, yeah, so that's a great team right there. So I've been picking that up as well.
That sounds like a good one for sure. Worth the read, no doubt. Honestly, it's good stuff, man. Good stuff.
And y'all, what have y'all been reading recently? Anything new or anything back issues you're catching up on?
I'm catching up like a lot of the Fourth World stuff. I finally got Kirby's New Gods run, 1-11, and then I got the Mr. Miracle 1-18, nice, which is really good. And Commandy. Went through Commandy.
Oh, that's cool. So you're getting all the Kirby stuff, huh?
Yeah. That's OMAC. Awesome. I think it's OMAC. I just got the Legion of Superheroes trade, the Great Darkness Saga.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
I love that. And then I got the Punisher Circle of Blood series, the Mike Zeck one.
Yeah.
I've been kind of going back on those and trying to get all those collected.
That's awesome. And you, Chuck, you reading anything?
Great stuff. A little bit. I've been trying to read some Dr. Doom stuff that I can find. AA and I covered Emperor Doom, which was super fun. I loved it. Yeah. And I had been picking up, the stuff is stacked up. I just haven't read it, but like I got the Garth Ennis' Get Fury. I'm gonna probably get started on that. Well, now that I'm gonna be off from work a couple weeks with this recovery stuff, so I'm hopefully gonna get some reading in. But that, and I've got the Ultimate Spider-Man, the one that everyone's been talking about.
I've got that whole run, that whole series, and I haven't read a single one yet.
I read 1 and 2, and I liked it. And I was like, okay, I like where this is going. I want to get back into it. And then their books are there, but I just had to start reading them.
Yeah.
So that one, and I picked up that new one that's, I guess it's him and Miles, like they're kind of like teaming up.
Spider-Man?
Yeah, mm-hmm. Spider-Man. Yeah. I want to check out some more of that one too. That's what I've got on the pile, but I've also got that Masters of the Universe Revolution in my pile too. Nice. I just haven't gotten to it. It's just there sitting there. So
Yeah, same thing. I've been picking up the Ultimate Spider-Man. Once you said you had read 1 and 2, I do remember reading 1 because there was just so much hype and people were talking about it. I was like, I can't have this like ruined for me.
Right.
So I read issue 1, but other than that, I haven't read anything else.
Yeah, I was kind of reading it with my nephew too, because he was kind of reading it, and then he got ahead of me, and I don't think he realizes I have the other issues there, so I got to make sure I let him know that.
Oh, you know what? I just remembered I've been reading a bunch of stuff on the Hoopla app from the library. All the Energon Universe stuff, like Void Rivals Volume 2 just came out, so I have that in my borrow that I need to read, but everything else so far, the Void Rivals Volume 1, Duke, Cobra Commander, and Transformers, all those Volume 1s, man, everything in that Energon universe has been awesome so far.
Man, that
Double A was on a hunt for some old Joe books, right? Double A, not that long ago.
Yeah, because they're like, I was like, damn, these are pretty still affordable. A lot of these early issues, and I told CM, I was like, man, their first appearances are kind of spread out. They're not like in the first 10 issues. It's like, you know, he comes out on issue 11. This one comes out in 20, and you know, Serpentor comes out in 49. And I was like, they're all pretty damn spread out. You know, I was like, so I was trying to go through, but a lot of places that don't have a lot of back issues of the Joes anymore.
Yeah. You know,
so I was like, that's true.
Yeah, all that Larry Hama stuff, right? That's the stuff.
Yeah, I need to check out that Hoopla app you're mentioning, though, Nas. I don't think I've checked that one out yet.
Yeah, definitely. Like I said, Bibliotech is going to be there at the show, so if you need to sign up, they'll get you signed up right there, man.
That'll be awesome for sure, for sure.
But yeah, they have a bunch of stuff on there. I've also, since Christopher Priest is going to be joining us, I wanted to like kind of refresh my memory on his Black Panther run. And they have like the big omnibus like collections digitally in the Hoopla app.
Wow.
Dang. Holy crap. Great.
Yeah, man. And there's so much of that stuff that I didn't remember. Like, I didn't remember Priest is the one that created Everett Ross that we see in the Black Panther movies and the Dora Milaje.
The Dora Milaje. He's all that.
Yeah, he's all that. Yeah.
That's so awesome, man. Yeah, that's going to be so great. Real quick, I want to give a shout out to the chat. Abe Dunks TV says, what's up, guys? Hey. Finally caught it live, and he threw $1.99 at us. We appreciate that.
All right.
Always, brother. Thank you so much. He says, Double A with the guns showing right there.
Okay, let me take that.
There we go. Yeah, we appreciate that, Abe, man. Of course, it's always nice when we get a little bit of kickback from the audience here. Very cool. Abe does a great show too, guys, talking about The Boys. He's watching The Boys catching up, so it's a great podcast. You to go check it out, The Boys from Texas, if you guys get a chance. Check out Abe's podcast.
That's another one. We watched the first three seasons and need to watch season four now.
What'd your wife think of that?
I mean, she liked it for a while, but we did have to take a break. There was just too much blood and shitty humans. Yeah, man. It definitely needed a palate cleanser afterwards.
it gets dark, you know what I mean? Real quick, you know, The Boys, it's like, oof, there's like no feel-good moments in this.
But there's so much stuff that we need to watch, man, that's just like, I think I've brought this up to you guys before, but it's just like when we were kids, like, never would we imagine this many comic book shows and movies, man. That's why, like, when people like complain about stuff, I'm like, you know, like 12-year-old you would have been like losing your damn mind over this stuff and just so happy that there was more of it.
Dude, we were excited when Wizard did a casting call for a book or a shirt or that we liked. We're like, oh damn, it's X-Men, you know?
So
no, absolutely, man. Now, Nazra, are you going to get out to the movies for anything? I know I feel like you're too busy for the movies, but are you going to get out for Joker?
Probably not. The next like the next like 2 weeks are going to be pretty busy, because not only is CASA on October 5th, but then CASA will be at Big Texas Comic Con for that weekend, the next weekend.
Okay.
Because so we're bringing Marvel artist Chris Campagna to Big Texas.
Oh wow! So you are involved with that? Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah. That's cool. They reached out to me a few months ago asking if I could help them with some artist booking. And Chris is, of the names I gave them, Chris was who they were interested in. So Chris Campagna is going to join us.
Yeah, because I was going to go to the Friday show.
Oh, okay.
I was going to go to that one. I was going to see Tyler Kirkham and what's her name?
Rafina. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and Chris too. I was going to check him out too.
Yeah. Definitely. Yeah, so, if you're looking for any.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, if you're looking for anything from Chris, he just did an amazing Spider-Man variant, I think came out 2 weeks ago. And then this week he had the CASA miniseries. He had a variant cover for number 2. Ooh,
nice.
So yeah, Chris is really like starting to blow up. I think Big Texas got him at a good time before he gets too big, because like just every month is more variant covers, more interiors that he's doing. Like he did an issue of Blood Hunt number 3, I think last month. So yeah, just more and more Marvel stuff is going to be coming out from Chris Campagna.
Man, that's great. Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Really great.
So yeah, man, as far as the movies, like I said, we've got about a week till CASA. Then after that, I've got a week until Big Texas. And then I think after that, then I can like catch up on stuff.
Yeah. Yeah. Joker might be on the wait list for you there then.
Well, that one's way down on the list because I haven't seen the first one yet.
Whoa. All right. You know, all right.
You know, I was going to say that right now they're saying that it's kind of tracking kind of low. Joker,
that's what I heard.
Mm-hmm. And I'm kind of wondering it's because maybe the tone of the first one is, I mean, it's really depressing. Like, you got to be like in the mood to see that Bruce Joker.
Yeah. Well, I think that's why I haven't like rushed out to like see it yet.
Yeah.
Like with other stuff that's come out, I'll be like, you know what? Do I want to be depressed or do I want to be happy for a couple of hours?
Yeah.
And it's literally why I can't wait for like Wolverine and Deadpool Wolverine to come home, because I'm like, you know what? I just feel good when I watch that movie. Yeah, I was like, it doesn't. You can say what you want about the plot, but I just have a fun time watching it. So.
Yeah, exactly.
You know,
what else do I need to catch up on? I want to watch The New Crow. I definitely got to see that. And that's already like in home digital. So,
yeah.
So I'll be able to watch that one from home. So.
No doubt. Oops, I'm getting out of focus here. There we go. Yeah. Yeah. AA and I each saw that one in the theater. We were kind of split opinion on that one, but I think we kind of knew that it might have gone that way. So, but you know, I think at home you can't go wrong. You know what I mean? So
I'm really curious to check it out. Like I'm wondering if people would have felt different about it if they just didn't call him Eric Draven.
That's all I was saying too.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's exactly what AA said when we had our conversation about it.
I thought he did a hell of a job.
Really?
Bill Skarsgård. Yeah, I thought he did a good job.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know. And I always like take the negative comments with a grain of salt, because is it a bunch of like people like our age that, you know, idolized the original one and loved it because it hit us at just the right time when we were angsty teenagers, you know? And so, or is it actually like it just wasn't good, you know? Because I think one thing a lot of people forget about is like this stuff can't always be for us, you know? If this character is going to keep going, they've got to update it and they've got to make it for a new audience, you know?
Absolutely. Yeah. No, absolutely. And you know, part of that thought process right there, and Oz, is what made me say, I told AA, he was like, I can't believe you went and saw it in theaters. And I said, well, you kind of opened my eyes. He said, I got to get my blinders off. I got to say, okay. And I really liked him in Barbarian. I thought he did a great job in the little bit of time that he's in that Skarsgård. And I said, man, you know what? I think this guy could pull it off. And again, he was a bright spot of it. There were other things I felt that were wrong, but.
Well, that's what I was going to say. So who was split? Who was the one that didn't like it and who did?
I did not care for it.
Yeah, he didn't care for it.
Okay.
But he told me before, he was like, you're not going to like it. Don't go see it in theaters. I said, let me give it a chance. I can be open-minded. And I was like, ooh, I didn't like it.
Okay. So was it just like it wasn't a good like revenge movie, or you just didn't like it because it was Eric?
You know what? I think I got a little bit stuck on that too. But also there was some other things that were like, I like that they tried to give us a little bit more Shelley, because they do a lot in the original without there being a lot of Shelley. But there was no chemistry between him and her. And I understand she's like a musician, not an actress. Yeah. And I felt like he was kind of like, he was dialed in, but she was not, it wasn't like.
Okay. So it was more her performance.
Right. Yeah. Oh, okay. You really weren't feeling it on that too. And then there were a couple of things that I felt like, I was like, what? There wasn't enough action, like for me, like for a Crow movie. I was like, okay, he needed a little bit more. You know what I mean? That original one almost has like a video game type vibe to it, where he kind of goes through several, you know, underlings before he gets to the big boss. And this one, that doesn't have that aspect. So you're left kind of like, well, what are we doing then for this hour and a half, you know, while he figures it out? You know what I mean? So
that was
it needed a little bit of restructuring for me, I think.
Okay.
Personally. But
at least like that can, like, I can accept your critiques, because it's not, he's not Brandon Lee. I hate
him. Right. And again, I could have got on that soapbox really easily, but like I said, AA was like, hey, you kind of got to think about it like this. And I said, you know what? You're right. And I've been wrong before. I've done that before. And so I said,
way to go, AA. Show him the light.
Dude, I'm telling you, this is my conscience right here. This guy is the guiding light. So I say,
I told him, I was like, well, the 94 Crow really didn't stick with the the book either, you know.
Yeah, that's the thing. When I saw some of those comments about like it's not like the comic, I was like, neither was the other one.
Which I didn't know that too. So I was okay, see, so I'm learning something here too. Yeah. This is kind of what me and Double A talked about with what did we just talk about? The new Batman, the Caped Crusader. Because mm-hmm. I was like, hey, Double A, is that like that? And then he said, well, that's, they're kind of going back old school. And I said, oh, okay. So I didn't know that. Because I was at first kind of hurt when they did it with my boy Clayface. I was like, oh man, this isn't like Clayface from, you know, animated series. I was like, that's one of the characters I like better. You know what I mean? Yeah, so I like any character that Batman is up against that I'm like, nah, they're right and you're wrong, Batman. Like you just want to get revenge only and not let anybody else get revenge.
Well, so. I was really glad that by the end of the season, he was less of a jerk to Alfred. That was the thing that was pissing me off every episode when he's just like, Pennyworth. I'm like, he raised you. Yeah. You be nice to him.
Yeah, man. That's like your pseudo dad, man. Chill out.
Yeah, but then like you saw that there was a reason they were showing him that way, because it led to the end where he finally like learns, you know? I'm like, okay, all right. Right.
And me and Double A had talked about that too, that the Alfred Bruce relationship in the movie, the Batman, was also like kind of bothersome, because it's like, I said, hold on now. This is like, again, like the man that raised you and you're being a jerk to him after he just got blown up for you. Yeah. You know, I'm like, screw you, Batman. Yeah. Plus we love Andy Serkis too. And I was like, I thought he was a good Alfred. See, it's just weird with these Batman movies, get right and wrong, right? It's like they, if they focus on one relationship, then they kind of lack in the other. You know what I mean?
Yeah, so,
but you know, we digress. I enjoyed the Caped Crusader. I thought it was really good. I was like, hey, this was really cool. Like, they pulled something off that I wasn't really sure. I was like, more Batman? Like, that's a lot.
Yeah, like I said, I was kind of worried since it was the same team of Bruce Timm and James Tucker. Like, as much as I loved all the Timverse stuff, like, it kind of, I felt like we needed something, like, different and new. And I was worried it was going to be just more of the same Batman the Animated Series or Justice League Unlimited type stuff. But now, like, there was enough different that, like, it was like, okay, cool. This is its own thing, you know?
Yeah, and it gave off, like, it had, like, a fun, like, vibe of, like, that period piece almost. And I told Double A, I was like, man, the Harley, the way they have her was really creepy. I was like, oh, she's, like, look creepy. And I was like, I don't know, she's giving me off, like, real psycho vibes, you know?
Yeah, man. Yeah, I can't wait till they get into more of those characters. Like I'd love to see, like, their version of, like, the ventriloquist. When Harvey like picks up the little stuffed pig for that one patient, I'm like, okay, is that Professor Pig? Like, where are you going with that? So like, yeah, man, I can't wait. Like, who knows with the, since they don't have like the ratings that they have to worry about being on a streaming service, like maybe we even get Hush, maybe we get Mr. Zaz, maybe, you know. So
that would be really cool. You know, that's kind of like you're kind of getting into territory. And I think we might have talked about it a little bit, Nas, when we had you on last. But what I had really hoped for with, you know, X-Men 97 and maybe in this season two is to really see like some really like Age of Apocalypse episodes or, you know, things that we didn't or Onslaught stuff that we didn't really get to see in the original series. And obviously when you have characters like you're talking about, you can go even darker, which kind of makes me think, made me a thought pop in my head, two thoughts actually. First thought, we didn't talk about the Bat getting his star on the Walk of Fame, right, guys? What do you guys think, the first comic book right character to have his, should it That's have been awesome. Him should it have been Soup, should it have been Spidey?
Batman.
I don't know. I think it should have been Superman, but they've done so much more with Batman, like over the last like 20 years or so.
It's like Double A. And a couple people I heard too that said it was the very Hollywood choice to make, was to make it Batman. And I agree. Like I said, he's always on the plate, right? We've got several Batman. We've got the Joker movie. We've got the cartoon. You know, so it's like, well, I guess, you know what I mean? But as a Superman guy, you know, and even as I would say, you know, as a Marvel guy, I would have been happy with Superman or Spidey being first, but if Batman's the one, then it's already there. I guess they'll get theirs, you know what I mean?
So, yeah, it was cool. I saw pictures of the event, and like I liked that they got together all the Batman voice actors that were available. Yeah. You know, of course, cool. Kevin Conroy is not with us anymore, but Diedrich Bader was there, and Hamlish, man, I forget his last name, the guy from Caped Crusader, he was there. Okay. And like, so I was like, oh, that's cool.
That's cool. Did Jim Lee go?
Yeah, yeah. Jim Lee was there.
Nice.
I saw a picture with him. He was like helping put the star down.
I love that, man. I love that. I love that for him too, because it's like I feel like he's a guy that we all grew up with, right? Like we saw Jim Lee like our whole life. You know what I mean?
From X-Men to Wildstorm to
To being like the man at DC, right?
That's crazy, right? Like he was like the guy that was one of the Image creators. Sold Wildstorm to DC, and now he's in charge of DC.
So he's got to be what, like maybe just a few years older than us? He can't be that much older than us, right? He looks good.
No, he looks good, but yeah, I think he's in his 50s, isn't he?
Okay, so he's probably about 10 years older.
Oh, actually, he's 60.
Yeah. No shit. Yeah. Damn, yeah. Jimmy looks good.
Yeah. He just had a birthday in August.
I was hearing Liefeld's podcast, and he was talking about the Heroes Reborn. Mm-hmm. And he was saying, like right when Marvel was, like, at the bankruptcy point, that Jim Lee almost took over Marvel.
Oh, really?
Almost took over Marvel, but Bill Gemmis stopped that deal from happening.
Oh, wow.
And
wow.
That's when him and C.A.S.A. kind of took over and kind of rebranded Marvel all over again. So instead that's when he went to DC. He sold to DC and then started making his way up. So
I mean, that worked out with Marvel, because with C.A.S.A. there and Jimmy Palmiotti, you know, that's when they launch Marvel Knights.
Yeah.
And that's when we get the Marvel Knights Punisher, and we get that Black Panther run that Christopher Priest worked on. And that was
it's kind of crazy to think that Jim Lee almost came close to running Marvel. At one point,
there's that alternate universe somewhere, guys. Yep. That timeline. I wonder what's going on over there.
Yeah.
What about that new Watchmen that came out? Did either of you guys get a chance to check that out? The new animated one.
I'm kind of waiting for it. I'm waiting for it to come out. Like with the Crisis, I'm waiting for part 3 to come out on Max before I see all 3 of them.
So. Yeah. I had interest, but I hadn't checked it out. But, you know, Watchmen, I feel like, is always one of those you can always go back to.
It's pretty much straight from the book, almost. Oh, okay. Just, you know, panel for panel, page for page.
We're just getting it in a... Like that.
Yeah, in an animated book.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I've heard good things about it, but no, I haven't gotten to watching it yet. But, man, I love that Watchmen, the show, the live-action show that I was kind of hoping that would come back and we'd get more of that in that universe.
Yeah, that would have been really awesome. You know, I think I had saw it before AA, and I said, man, it really plays really well as like a true sequel to the book. Mm-hmm. And I said, I was really shocked at how well they were able to pull that off. And
I think, it just worked. I think Dave Gibbons gave his thumbs up.
Yeah.
I think he said he liked it.
Yeah. 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 And I think
Alan Moore's probably hating it somewhere.
No. Oh, definitely. He said he's not going to watch it. He's like, they fucked up all his adaptations. So.
I want to find an adaptation that Alan Moore likes. Has he liked anything? Has he ever said?
He hated From Hell. He didn't like League of Extraordinary Gentlemen. He hated that one.
That one was a lot of people.
A lot of people hate it.
Pretty much he hasn't liked any of them.
Swamp Thing's not his, but yeah.
But they get a lot of stuff, I would think, from his run.
Right.
The one I hear they kind of stopped making is Neil Gaiman, because Neil Gaiman's going through some charges against him that they kind of halted production on some of his stuff now.
Oh, really? Man, I wanted to see season 2 of Sandman. That was really good.
I know, I want to see that real bad.
Man, that's one thing. Can we talk about that? I am so tired of these like huge waits in between seasons, man.
Yeah,
like
we only 10 episodes too, right? It's like,
yeah, that's the thing too. You make us wait like 2-3 episodes. Years. Yeah, you make us wait 2-3 years, and then you come back with 8 or 10 episodes. Yeah. Like, what the heck? What happened to what happened to like network TV? Those people could get out 24 episodes, take 3 months off, and be right back.
Dude, I was ready for the fall season when it was fall. Now I'm like,
oh man. I know, 2025? And here I, I know I sound like an old man now, like network TV, remember that? but for real, man, like I can't believe we have to wait so long between stuff.
Dude, like literally not us, every week we're complaining about that being AA. Yeah, no, just like The Last of Us, you're right. It's been already, what, like a year and a half?
Yeah, yeah. And that teaser trailer just came out, and I was like, wait, what exactly happened in the last one?
Exactly. these networks got to remember that the people that they're marketing to are getting older, so all the memories aren't sticking up there.
Well, not just that, but it's just like there's so much stuff. Is that like, man, we can move on to something else real quick, you know? Mm-hmm. So I don't know.
No doubt. I think about it all the time, like stuff that I didn't finish. And I'm like, why didn't I finish watching that? And I was like, I think I just started watching other stuff.
Yeah.
That was it, mm-hmm. straight up, you know?
Yeah. That's what happened to me with a lot of the CW shows. Like, you know, I'm a huge NBA fan. And since it's been off season, I was like, you know what? Let me go back and finish Legends of Tomorrow. Like, I never finished that. Mm-hmm. And then I finished that, and then I'm like, oh, you know what? I never watched the last two seasons of Flash. Let me get on that. So, yeah, man, there's lots of stuff that's just like your attention goes somewhere else, and you forget about it, you know?
Yep, absolutely. I haven't finished Titans yet, and I know they've got that last season out there, and I was like, mm-hmm. I need to get to it. I just hadn't got to it. And Double A got me watching The Bear, so I've been watching The Bear. I'm getting mm-hmm. close to wrapping it up, but that one's been great.
Yeah.
But yeah, man. So
yeah, they
so,
should learn their lesson. There's too much stuff to take our attention. You better give us some more of that popular thing, or we're gonna forget.
Absolutely, man. Yeah, man. Let's talk a little bit of wrestling, though, Nas. I know you don't get to talk about wrestling probably too much, right?
Oh, that's something else I've been catching up on during the off season.
Okay, because I've been kind of out of the loop, and I think Double A maybe also. I don't know if he's caught anything recently, but mm-hmm. I know we're both always kind of reading updates on what's
the
going
dirt
on,
sheets
but... Yeah, I looked at the dirt sheets a little bit. Yeah.
No, man, I went back, I jumped back on into WWE at WrestleMania, mm-hmm. and so I've been watching since WrestleMania, and then TNA, I jumped back into TNA from I think Slammiversary, so it was around that same time. So yeah, I've been watching both of those. And man, I cannot believe, like, the NXT and TNA partnership, that stuff has been amazing, dude.
Really?
Yeah. And it's so much better than when TNA was working with AEW. AEW kind of treated them like the stepchild. Like, you guys put our stars on your show and, like, talk about how great they are. And, like, your guys might show up on our show, but we won't even mention where they're from. But no, with the NXT and TNA stuff, like, it's going back and forth, and they're making the TNA wrestlers look really strong on NXT TV, and it's cool, man.
That's great, man. I hadn't known that they were doing that collaboration, so that's awesome.
Yeah, that's been awesome. Really awesome. Rosemary from TNA has shown up in NXT. Joe Hendry, who's like super popular in the NXT crowd,
this guy's name.
Yeah, NXT crowd is chanting his name. I'm like, wow, this is cool, man.
I dig it, man. I dig it. Do. Double A, what are you catching any wrestling stuff like that?
Let me see. I saw this past week's AEW because it was Bryan Danielson and Nigel McGuinness. I don't know if you heard TM, but
no,
Nigel
came back.
Yeah, I couldn't believe. I didn't know that he had come back. Like, the last I had seen was when he was still a commentator for WWE.
I stopped
watching, and then I think just like a week ago on my like Facebook feed or something, I saw a clip of him, and I was like, "What? He's back in the ring? That's awesome!"
Yeah, it was his first match back in like 11 years or some shit like that.
That's so crazy. Yeah. I'm glad he was able to get back in because he had to leave because of injury.
Yeah. The Bloodline, Roman's back. Yeah, so him and Cody have been going up against Solo and Jacob and the Gorillas. Yeah, they're there too. I don't know if you know the Gorillas of Destiny are there.
I didn't know. No, that's badass.
So Roman and Cody have been teaming up.
Yeah, the fake Bloodline.
I dig it, man. I dig it. So there's some good stuff going
on. The Bloodline is still going after, you know, WrestleMania. So
yeah, dude.
How was the match though, Double A, with Brian and
it was good.
McGuinness. It was a good match.
Yeah, okay. It was really good. Yeah.
No ring
and
rust.
And then TNA had two shows here in San Antonio.
Yeah, they were packed, man. They were sold out.
Yeah, mm-hmm. They were sold out. Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. They said they said that's been their best 2-day event in a long time. So I was like, man, badass.
Yeah, hopefully this whole year they've been killing it. Like I think it was Slammiversary or one of the other events I was watching, and they said the crowd was like 3,000, 4,000, and that was like the biggest crowd that they've had this year. And then I think they beat that when they were here in San Antonio. So,
dude, I love when San Antonio comes out, you know what I mean, for anything, but, you know, for wrestling especially, too, because that just means we'll get more of that good stuff, right? Dude, I love it. I love it. Double A, what other, did you have other questions for Nas, you know, regarding, you know, either the show or just in general?
I was going to see if I got to get going soon, guys, but if you guys wanted to wrap up about the show or anything you wanted to talk about.
Double A?
Let me see. Like you're having your big guests are Terry Cavanaugh, Chris Caprice, Chris Allen, and Rob Guillory.
Yeah. And then I can't fit everybody on the flyer, but we've got some other bigger names like Nick Patara, if people know his work from the Manhattan Projects, you know, that kind of stuff. Chris Sheehan, I don't know how much people might be familiar with him, but people definitely, if you're a horror fan, keep an eye on Chris. Chris is like an up and coming, like horror comic artist, man. Like the stuff he's coming out with, like always looks super creepy. He just, he's doing art on a new space horror series called Dark Empty Void. That looks really cool. So yeah, man, we've got, I think like, I've been telling everybody, I think this is going to be our biggest, best year yet.
I love it. I love it.
Yeah, man. I'm super excited. I mean, Terry Cavanaugh and, you know, Christopher Priest alone should bring in a lot of people. You know, I mean, those two guys worked on a lot of great stuff.
Yeah. So, and, you know, and they're both, you know, I'm always kind of selfish with this stuff and I want to meet people that worked on Spider-Man. So, bringing Terry and then Christopher Priest, who was, you know, an editor on the Spider books during all that Hobgoblin, like, controversy, and he said it should be neat. Ned Leeds, while DeFalco and friends said it should be somebody else. And so I don't know if I'm going to ask him right off the bat when I pick him up from the airport, or if I'll like wait till later in the weekend to ask him about that.
Wait till we're all around, Nas, and ask him when we're all standing around so we can hear too.
Yeah, I don't even know if I'll ask him at all because I know he's like had some blog posts on his website where he's like, I don't talk about that anymore.
I love it, Nas. Well, we're super excited for you. We're super excited to be a part of the show.
And thank y'all so much for bringing me on again to talk about it. You know, one of the hardest things is just getting the word out there and getting people to know about the show. So thank you all again for having me.
We'll help to you this week. We'll put up like all your artists, writers, and the books that they've worked on. So
yeah,
we'll be doing that all week. You know, so.
And I'm glad you guys will be able to be out there too. Are y'all bringing any swag or stickers or anything? What are y'all going to have?
Yeah, man, I got stickers printed up. I got some other stuff that I sent out for today. I don't know if it'll be here in time, but we definitely got the big this is my favorite sticker that we get from our buddy in Ohio, Justin. Yeah, these are the ones with the QR code in the middle you can scan. And they're made for weathering, for sticking on a car or anything like that. or a cooler of beer, you know what I mean? So
y'all aren't drinking tonight.
I know. I'm drinking water. I'm trying to hydrate here with medication. But normally we would be. Yeah.
Okay. Definitely, guys. I'm glad to have you guys part of the show. And thank y'all so much for being like part of the show and supporters of the show since last year. So I really appreciate it.
Absolutely, man. You guys got to run. I want to get one of those new shirts.
Oh, yeah. The new one. Oh, man. I wish I had one with me so I could show. But yeah, definitely. We've got it's going to be glow in the dark ink on the on the shirt. Art is done by one of our exhibitors, Mike Fisher. So Mike has a really great like retro space girl vibe that he loves doing. So that's what he's doing on our shirt.
Yeah. No, and awesome. I use that as the banner for when this episode comes out. That's I grabbed that picture and then I threw the dates in the corner. And also when this comes out, that's what you'll see there. But this is where we can find you guys. You at right now is at comicarts.sa.
Yeah, that's our Facebook and our Instagram handle.
guys, if you don't know already, go check out Comic Arts San Antonio. It's an amazing, fun show. Comic book artists, comic book writers, people that are in the business. You know, we talked about, you know, AA mentioned, you know, the bigs, you know, like, you know, Kavanaugh and Priest. But the opportunity to learn about new stuff is always so much fun, right? Get in there and mix it up and meet these other creators that are, you know, making new things and new stuff for us to read and pick up. So I think it's always fun as an opportunity to enlighten yourself, you know what I mean, yeah. To new things.
Yeah, and you never know when one of these is going to be the next movie or TV show, right?
Exactly, exactly. Yeah. And I'm sure there's people like scouts out there just waiting for the next thing, man. Yeah. So, well, hey, Nas, we know you're super busy, man, and you got to get back to it, get back on that grind, so we'll let you get out of here, bud. We appreciate right. your time, and we hey, can't wait to see y'all. You next week.
All right, yep. Thank y'all again. Have a good all one,
right.
y'all.
Cool. All right, Nas, yeah. Talk to you later, bud. Well, AA, there you have it, right? The man himself, Nas, you know, Comic yep. Arts, man. It's a great show. It's so much fun. You know what I mean? I think that this is what a novel idea, right? Like, I feel like yeah. it's something that we could have thought of, like, why don't we just have a comic book show with just comic books?
Yeah, but I know, like I said, we've talked to Mario, you know, and he's always said what a headache it is to try and put one of these together. So
I know. So yeah, kudos. But, I mean,
super cool that he's getting these people. Like you said, we'll be posting the writers and artists, and we'll be pushing some of their work so you'll kind of know, like, who's who. Like, I'm really excited because Terry Cavanaugh was not just a writer for Spider-Man and X-Men, but he was an editor during the Marvel Comics Presents.
Oh, nice.
He was the editor during Barry Windsor Smith's Weapon X run.
Wow, so that's great. That
editor. Yeah, so, you know, so we'll be doing a lot. And like he said, Christopher Priest, he's the one that introduced a lot of the Black Panther stuff that you saw in the movie. He's the one that introduced a lot of that stuff. So yeah.
I think
that's going to be really cool.
Did you lend me those books? You have those yes, books, right? Yeah, I think those are the ones you lent me.
Yeah, and I have that one here. So, I mean, that's really going to be cool. So, man, if you like the Black Panther movies, you know, you want to meet this guy because he's the one, you know, they took a lot of his stuff and put it in the movie. So,
yeah, you know, very cool.
Really cool, you know. Very and then Chris cool. Allen, he's doing right now, his current work is Black Panther versus Predator. So,
dude,
that's super awesome too.
I got to pick up one of those issues to get that one signed for mm-hmm. sure, because that's yeah. just badass, man.
Yeah.
Well, shit, AA, this is a good one, man. Nice and yeah. tight. Got to talk yeah. with our bud Nas, and then yeah. next week we'll I be know, doing
he,
it again.
He's some timing for us, so yeah. So yeah. that was super cool. You know, so.
Yeah.
Thanks again. Sure. Appreciate it.
Yeah, Nas, thank you, brother. We can only imagine, like we said, what you're going through and putting on yeah. a show, but we appreciate that. And I hope that the people of San Antonio will appreciate it and the surrounding areas. I hope people come down from, you know, Austin and New Braunfels, and people that love comics come up from the valley.
Because if you love the Black Panther movie, I mean, man, this is a big deal with Christopher Priest coming. So
yeah, and real comic book people know that this is a kind of a cool one of a kind event for $8, right? AA.
Yeah.
We just
yeah,
talked $8. About We can't even get in to meet, you know, Jim Starlin again because it's going to be $75 just to get in. That sucks.
Yeah, so we have a local Comic-Con here, again, too, in October. It's not the end of October. And Jim Starlin's coming. I told CM, oh, man, you know, Jim Starlin's coming back. You know, yeah, I can get more shit for him to sign. And it's like Friday is $75. Saturday is $95. And Sunday is $85. So it's like... like, damn, like, that's how much I was going to spend on Jim Starlin.
Yeah.
You know, now I got to spend it on this fucking ticket just to get in. It's just like, I told Sam, yeah. I was like, nah, that's really just turning me off. Like, really, those prices are just, it's cool. I mean, don't get me wrong. He's getting a lot of badass guests. This Comic-Con, I think it's run by Thomas J. Henry, but those prices, man, it's just,
it's man, bonkers, it's hard. Man. My dad is bound and determined to go to the Space Con because he wants to meet Rosario Dawson. Oh, that's the one. Yeah.
The one that Jim Starlin's going to be there. Yeah.
I don't know. I got to talk to dad about that and say, I got to figure out a day that's going to be affordable, you know?
And it's like not set though. It's kind of like, it's really the quality, I guess, of the people you're bringing in, and you know, that the ticket prices have to go up, you know, so that gets affected. So, yeah, you're bringing in Hayden Christensen. You're bringing Ewan McGregor, Rosario Dawson. You're bringing in William Shatner, the Star Trek Next Generation crew, the Deep Space Nine, all that kind of shit, the Star Wars crew. It's like, yeah, that's gonna be fucking pricey as hell.
So, yeah, pricey as hell for us, the going audience, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. So
I'm just like,
you know, and again, we say comic convention, but it's like not really comics.
It's not. No,
it's like Nas said, it's like a pop culture show, which is great.
It's called Comic Con. So let's get one guy in there, you know. Let's get Jim Starlin in there, you know. So.
Yeah, and you know, we do a pop culture podcast, so we talk pop culture. We love that, you know what I mean. But you know, Nas is putting on a real comic show for comic book fans and comic book lovers, and he's charging
$8 is nothing.
That's old school, man. That's freaking. Yeah. This is the days double A when your mom was taking us to the Embassy Suites, right? Those those old shows, man. Yeah. And I just love that. I love that retro vibe of it.
I do too.
Giving back, you know, Nas is giving back to comic book fans. So I love it, and we wish him all the success. And again, we'll be there if you guys want to come and get a sticker. We'll be there. I'll have plenty of these available for you.
Yeah, we'll have an interview too. Like, if you guys want to like chat and tell us about who you met, what you bought, you know, we'll sit you down, and you know, you can tell us all about that too.
Absolutely, yeah, we'll be hanging out. We'll probably be recording a little bit, and then just hanging, probably. You know what I mean? Like we said, but talking with people. I mean,
if people want to, you know, show us, you know, they want to get on, they want to, you know, tell us about their experiences, you know, and all that. We'll be happy to have you on. You know,
absolutely. So. Yeah, absolutely. I'm looking forward to seeing some of our friends like Alfred and Bill from Nelco and you know, some of the other folks out there that we've gotten to know through these episodes, right, Double A?
Yeah.
Well, shit, bud. This was a good one. Let's wrap it up though. I'll give some time back to each other and back to the fans. Okay. We just want to remind everyone, all the information is here. You see, guys, you know, again, go check out at comicarts.sa. That's where you can find CASA again here, like on the shirt, right? C-A-S-A. It's like a house, but it's for Comic Arts San Antonio, where our good friend Nas puts on that show. And we're going to be out there again next week at the third annual.
Next Saturday, October 5th.
Yeah, Saturday, October 5th, for sure. And then in addition to that, guys, something we like to say at the end of every episode to remind all of you guys is that if there's something that you want to do, a hope, a dream, something that you wish to accomplish, go out and do it, guys. There's no time like the present. Seize the day, right? Double A, carpe diem. Yeah. Obviously, Nas seizing the day by creating his own freaking comic book show, which is super kick-ass to us.
And hoping another one. Right. Yeah. And then helping Big Texas Comic Con. So
absolutely. Right. Loaning his talents, man. Loaning his talents. And the other thing we like to say, we like to quote right out of the pages of the comic book. So, but the great Captain Steve Rogers, who reminds us, you know, during the end game, before they go back on the time heist, that they must do whatever it takes, guys. So sometimes that is what you have to do is in order to make that happen, is to do whatever it takes. So seize the day, guys, do whatever it takes. And make those things happen. And we look forward to seeing you guys next week, right, Double A?
Yes, sir.
All right, guys. Well, I'm CM Chuck.
I'm Double A.
We're Just Another Friday Night, guys. San Antonio's premier pop culture podcast with P Breaks live on Friday nights. And we can't wait to see you guys all next week out at CASA Comic Arts San Antonio. Come meet us. Come check us out. Come hang out for a little bit. All right, guys. We'll talk to you later. Have a good night.